Welcome to the JMIR TV channel. My name is Gunther Eysenbach. I am the publisher and founder of JMIR Publications. And we are celebrating this year our 25th anniversary, 25th anniversary of the Journal of Medical Internet Research. And that was obviously the first journal we published 25 years ago. And from there, we grew our little empire of JMIR journals, now 30 journals. And it's a pleasure to introduce Juan Alperin as one of our guests in this little podcast series. Welcome, Juan. Do you want to start introducing yourself?
Thank you for the invitation to join in on the celebration, Gunther. So I'm Juan Pablo Alperin. I'm an associate professor at Simon Fraser University and the scientific director of the Public Knowledge Project.
Yeah, and the Public Knowledge Project, of course, is the originator of the OJS system, the Open Journal Systems, which we have been using at JMIR Publications almost since the beginning. So in 2004, we switched to OJS. And Juan was actually one of our early employees. So he was hired as a software developer back in, it was 2006, I think.
2006, yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, what do you remember from these times, Juan?
This is, it really was my foray into the world of scholarly publishing. So I remember starting at the, right at the very beginning of 2006. I actually moved to Toronto right before to celebrate the new year and to start my year off with my work, with you and with JMIR. And I remember the work at that time was the migration of, JMIR from OJS 1, what had been fairly recently released OJS 2. And so I think over the time that the first few months I was there was sort of migrating the features and all of the innovations and additions to the software that had been done on that first version of OJS and making sure that JMIR was operating well on the most recent version.
Yeah. Back then we were also adding features to the core Open Journal Systems code base. We also donated that code as open source code. Do you remember what these modules were you were working on?
Yeah, there were several, and several of those plugins stuck around with OJS for a lot of this time. I'm trying to remember if some of them have even made it into OJS 3, but they certainly made it through the whole life of OJS 2. And so a few of the features that I remember having worked on back then, one was a CMS plugin to be able to add additional pages, so additional content that was not a part of the standard OJS structure. So that was one plugin that I stuck around with OJS for quite a while. Another one, which then migrated to being sort of a static pages plugin. There was another one for the sidebar and managing the elements on the sidebar of OJS. That's something that stuck through with OJS all the way through to the 2.48 line. And worked on the payments plugin. It was a PayPal plugin at the time, and then eventually morphed at PKP into a more generic payments plugin to be able to accept for article processing charges and other kinds of, as well as other kinds of receiving other kinds of payments. JMIR at the time was innovating with a few different models of receiving payments from authors. Those are the main ones that I remember working on. And I said, so many of those have stuck around as features for the lifeline of the 2.x line.
Yeah, I remember. I mean, the Journal of Medical Internet Research started as a diamond journal and was really just curated by a bunch of volunteers and volunteer editors, mainly me, to be honest. Then in around that time, in 2004 or so, Biomed Central started also charging article processing fees. And we thought that would be a good way to monetize the journal and to be able to afford people like you to work on the system as well. So yeah, that article processing fee module that was previously not in OJS, that was important work back then. Another thing that we worked on was were these XML conversion scripts, right?
Right. Yeah, so those were not features that were built into OJS, but were other innovations and software that we were building in the background. And I inherited some of those scripts from MJ Sohonos, who had been working in my role before my arrival. But then I continued to develop those scripts to help do the sort of automate as much as possible of the typesetting of creating the PubMed Central quality XML, including the full tagging of the references, which I remember was, as always, was one of the biggest challenges was tagging that part. A problem that to this day remains unsolved in terms of automating that work well.
Yeah, you're right. There's still people working on that very problem. How can we convert a file, be it a Word document or even a PDF, into a proper XML file so that it can be easily, more easily indexed in sites like PubMed Central? Yeah, so that was 20 years ago, almost 20, yeah, more, almost 20 years ago. What keeps you busy these days?
I mean, so I've been, since that time, then I went on to do my PhD and start my career as a professor. Now have grown into from being a contributor to OJS to being the scientific director of the project. So there are lots of things that's keeping us busy at PKP in terms of further innovations and continuing to build out that software and now being used by over 40,000 journals around the world. About half of them are in Indonesia, where there's a growing, like a rapidly growing journal market. So there's lots of things that we're doing there in terms of trying to building new features, actually building in XML into OJS and figuring out ways to do that. I've been doing a lot of work around trying to better understand this ecosystem of article processing charges and being able to support that. And a lot of research in front of my intersection with my career as a professor is doing research in this space. And right now, doing a lot of research on looking at the indexing of not just of OJS journals, but rather like indexing of small journals from around the world and spending some time looking at the OpenAlex database and trying to see the completeness and the quality of that metadata so that we can better continue to understand the scholarly publishing landscape, as well as being able to support services like discovery services or provide other kinds of services on top that require high quality metadata.
Yeah, I mean, you really have emerged as one of the leading scholars and voices in that space of open access and alt metrics. And yeah, we are a little bit proud of that. I'm pretty proud of that as myself, that kind of the humble beginnings at JMIR kind of led you down that
It's a story
path.
Adna, which I've told, and I always both acknowledge and I'm grateful for that opportunity. I think as I've told you before, I went into the job at JMIR because I was a software developer, and it was an interesting programming job, and it was a way of me paying off some of my student debts from my master's degree. And it was really this was a technical challenges and an interesting opportunity, but it was not my intended career path. And so the opportunities there around learning around the discussions around open access, and I remember being as part of a at the time being affiliated with the University Research Network and being part of that academic environment. I had opportunity to participate at events and conferences or seeing. I remember going into meetings, talking with people from Biomed Central with you and you bringing me along to those where I could kind of start to get that lay of the land and understanding what was happening. And then contributing to the open source sort of gave me that in with PKP and allowed me to sort of jump into doing that work in Latin America, which is what I wanted to do. But very much acknowledge and I'm grateful for the opportunity and that starting point at JMIR and working with you.
Yeah, that's great. And as I said, I mean, you're one of the leading voices. And what I think I also appreciate, and a lot of other people appreciate, is that you're kind of also a voice of areas of the world who are a little bit more underprivileged and have problems with the funding of article processing fees. And I think you also recently published a paper in Nature that spoke to that. Do you want to tell me a little bit more about that?
I've been working a lot, so one of the reason I actually left JMIR was not it was because I wanted to go back to Latin America, where I'm originally from, and it was a chance for me to move back home, and I just had the opportunity to keep doing some work with PKP during that time. But when I started doing that, I was running workshops on using OJS and moving journals online, and I got to really understand both the how much was happening in Latin America around open access publishing, where the vast majority of the journals are being published in open access. There were challenges there were around having visibility for their work, and then also professionalizing the practice of publishing. And so this is where the technology was coming in as a tool to help in both of those fronts, and it's been part of the success of OJS in the region. But we see that the models that has been operating in Latin America over this last decade and a half, which is largely what is now called Diamond, but it has always just been kind of institutional publishing in Latin America, universities taking on the cost of their publishing, is a little bit under being challenged now because of the dominance of the APC model, as they're having to siphon off limited resources in those regions to pay APCs, largely to subsidize the publishing and journals that are charging these, which are predominantly in the global north. And so it's become a bit of a tension and a problem for the region that's investing in its own publishing and then having to also send money to support the publishing in wealthier parts of the world. So I'm really seeing the APC model as something that is putting strain on what has been a fairly vibrant and growing and consolidating journal publishing landscape in the region. And so some of the work and that opinion piece that I wrote in for Nature was a way of trying to raise more awareness about the challenges that these fees, while they solve a problem for the journals, are creating a challenge for a model and an approach to publishing of another part of the world. And that's the same in other parts of the global south as well. But Latin America is just the area that I happen to have spent the most time in and that I know most intimately well.
Yeah, it is a big problem, and we are very well aware of that. Yeah, JMIR Publications, we also really don't like the article processing charge system. But you know, to do a professional job in publishing, money needs to come from somewhere, right? And the question is who at the end is paying the bill. I mean, we think it should be probably the funder, and the institution also has a role to play. Because I always say, like, in essence, institutions like universities kind of almost outsource evaluation of sometimes their students, sometimes their faculty. When they say, for example, you have to publish three papers in a journal to get your PhD, this is kind of an outsourcing of of that evaluation, right? And that costs money. And publishing also still plays a role, for better or worse, in the evaluation of faculty for tenure and promotion purposes. So I think there is a role for institutions. There's obviously also a role for funders to participate in that and to, like, put money on the table. I think, like, and we are promoting Plan P as an alternative, which is not so much article processing fee driven, but which also takes the APF apart and talks about a review fee and a curation fee. So that's basically the PRC model that we are promoting under what we call Plan P, and that we're also trying to sell to institutions. But this North-South problem is tricky. How to solve this, I frankly don't know, because this is.
Yeah, I would think that it's also, I don't quite see it as necessarily just a North-South problem. It's a problem of folks wanting the challenges around how do we allocate the limited resources that are available. And what ends up happening is a little, it's not exactly the tragedy of the commons, but it's a little bit of that coming into play where it's a lot easier to allocate budget to paying an APC when you're saying the alternative is, oh, this is what it costs to publish here. And so you can dedicate a line item to it. If you want to support diamond journals, if you want to support journals that are more broadly an infrastructure that's supporting open access publishing, that makes it so that we benefit from the collective of everybody kind of making that things available. It's a lot harder. It's a more lot more diffuse of like I'm paying, but what am I getting in return? And that providing payment, whether it be a funder or an institution, in saying I'm supporting the system being open, is not as easy as I'm paying for this article to be open. And I think that that is the same, that the tension that what's happening in Latin America now, where everyone was, because of historical reasons, not because they had it figured out, but because of the way that every institution was trying to promote itself, was willing to invest in, we'll make all of our journals open, and then that's going to make it open for everyone else. And so we got the collective benefit. I think we would do well in the global north to adopt such a model where every institution sort of supports the venues that they want to, that their researchers are participating in, that they have their researchers are being editors of, the communities that they're engaged with, but not in a transactional way, the way it works with APCs, but rather in a, we'll support that publishing, and we, in the hopes that everybody else will also support the other initiative that they're a part of, and that's how we fund the system. I'm concerned now when I see in the rise of preprints that we are trying to use them as a way of trying to provide this kind of open access, providing the access and then doing the reviewing on top. But as we move towards that as the solution to openness, because the APCs are becoming too much in terms of too many institutions charging for them, or too many journals charging for them, that we're going to start seeing the rise of saying, well, now we need to sustain that ecosystem. And so then if we end up putting the same model in place of where it's very transactional, we're going to arrive at the same channel. So there needs to be a change from this individual, like I'm putting money just for the thing that I'm getting directly in return, to something around people contributing the resources to making the system open. Here, I mean, very self-interested from my role at PKP, is that the importance and the value of providing the infrastructures that enable journals to be able to operate at a low cost and not charge APCs altogether. It's much harder for us to even attract people wanting to contribute to providing that kind of infrastructure. It's a harder sell for institutions to put the money, because they just trust someone else will put that money in and will use our resources to make sure our researchers are able to publish in the venues that they want to.
Yeah, I mean, I think funding the infrastructure like OJS is certainly important and has obvious benefits. On the other hand, I also think there will always be kind of a transactional cost, because like each manuscript creates cost, like to peer review and to edit, copy edit and typeset. We talked about that, even though those costs may come down, but it's still like each article still creates cost. And in that sense, I think a kind of a per unit reimbursement, or even if it's just an annual fee, as we have already like agreements with institutions that pay us a flat fee, where we say, okay, or you can publish for a certain flat fee, but that flat fee is kind of derived from a historical publication behavior as well, because like volume obviously counts. So there's this aspect that you kind of have to pay a little bit per article, as opposed to just, you know, pull a number out of your head and just fund the infrastructure.
Yeah, and I want to acknowledge that the recognition that there are real costs of doing high quality publishing. There's both fixed costs and there's marginal costs, right? So we can bring down the marginal cost to some extent through technological developments, through improvements, and like to a certain point. But there's some fixed costs that also are associated with running a publishing organization, whether it be a nonprofit publisher, a for-profit one, or whether it be institutional publishing, the way that libraries provide publishing programs. There's certainly costs that need to be recovered in some way. The challenge is around finding models that are able to have equitable participation and who's able to actually contribute to the research, and also in thinking about what does it mean for the larger ecosystem of other players also being able to participate in making their research knowledge available to the public. And this is the struggle and the challenges of finding those models. There's some interesting innovation things. People are experimenting. All of the attention being received right now for Diamond Open Access Publishing is a way of trying to draw attention to the need for different models and of people being able to finance and contribute actual money towards running these journals, so that it's, whether, you know, you could go back to being, let's say, a Diamond publisher, but that doesn't mean that you need to have less revenue. The same revenue needs to be coming in. It's a matter of who is it coming from and what are the models to make that possible. The subscribe to open model is another innovation, sort of another thing that we're seeing like growing in momentum, which is just another way, again, of trying to recognize that publisher needs to be able to pull in money to be able to fund the operations and fund all of that high quality work that gets done.
Yeah. I mean, diamond journals, I'm a little bit concerned sometimes that people hear, okay, diamond journal means author doesn't pay, reader doesn't pay. Great. So nobody has to pay. So.
No, yes. And that's a challenge in that community to make sure that that isn't the sense. But it's the challenge around open source or the challenge around thinking about open access. It's not that, oh, well, it's either you pay a subscription fee or you pay nothing. And it's that we can make those, same what we see with people paying, willing to pay tens of thousands of dollars to have, one of the other manuscript management systems that they charge a lot of money. Or they say, we can have OJS for free. And it's like, no, well, you can have OJS and you can then contribute to the project to make sure that it continues to be there. But too often people make that same kind of distinction of it's either a subscription or it should be nothing at all if it's diamond. And we need to recognize the costs that are really there. And that means that people need to be willing to contribute for something that's a public good, right? Contribute even to make it available for others to be able to have access.
Yeah, and so how do you see the future of publishing? Is it gonna be all like mostly preprints and just only the best work being published in journals, or?
The answer to this question, when I get asked any of these, it really depends on what day people catch me on. On my more optimistic days, I see sort of a bright future where I think that journals will continue to have a strong place to play. I think that they will go back to having the community organizing function that they had more traditionally had. I think as more and more things get published, people do look to narrow in and have ways of helping to focus their attention. And the journal and the curation that can happen on them can continue to be important. At the same time, I also see the rise of preprints. It grew a lot during the pandemic, what we see. It seems to be steady or rising depending on the fields, but it hasn't dropped back down from what we are able to observe. And I think we're going to start seeing more open review and journals doing that work of being able to publish things that are also available in preprint form. I hope to see that curation and review being organized still in something that looks like, somewhat looks like what journals have looked like, because I think that continues to be valuable. And I would love for preprints to remain valuable for what I think they're valuable for, which is for having an opportunity to publish. Anything can go into a preprint. It's not the curated things. That's sort of the place where anyone can share whatever they're working on and whatever is available, and having that inclusivity be there. And so I'm a bit, when you catch me on a more pessimistic or cynical day, I'm seeing all these efforts around curation and review around preprints as trying to transform preprints into journals. And not see the difference in the advantages that we get from both of the different modes.
Yeah, I think there are different things. There's preprints and then the journals, and then with JMIX, with the JMIX series of journals, we have created a new kind of journal series that sits on top of preprint servers and peer reviews them. And we refer to this as a journal, and it is indexed like a journal, but it has perhaps a little bit lighter peer review and hopefully faster production times. So this is kind of what we want to achieve with JMIX. But you have also done some interesting work on preprints and how they're used and how they're communicated by the media.
Yeah, that's work I'm pretty excited about. We're doing one more iteration on work we recently published. What we wanted to see, so we saw that the pandemic was really this opportunity for to see some of the best and the worst that preprints can offer in case of an emergency, right? The rapid review, the rapid publishing saw some very important research get out in a very timely way published in preprints. We also saw some things that ended up, with sort of false research or research that was kind of sending people really in the wrong direction. So we had the question of how are the media reacting to this? It was kind of a new thing to be reporting on these things that with the certification of peer review for what that's worth and all of its challenges we can leave aside. And we were able to see that really the media stepped up in terms of looking at preprints as a source for information, as a way of keeping the public informed, and seeing a sort of big increase in the proportion of research of the media stories that were covering research were reporting on preprints. So that's something that we just released publishing in the journal QSS, where we looked at that rise, primarily focused on seeing COVID-related preprints being covered so much more in the news. But it immediately got us to ask the question, now that the emergency phase of the pandemic is over, what is the media going to do? Will they continue to report on these things? And actually finding that they have drop back down to the pre-COVID levels of preprint media coverage. So some of the alarm and concern that is raised around, the media is reporting on all of these fake news, they're putting out research that hasn't been verified, that then gets retracted or proves to be false. My interpretation of this is that some of those concerns are a little bit overblown. And if we start sort of cautioning and not pushing back on preprints, because we think the media is going to, start sharing all of those things. I think what we're seeing is this reduction back to reporting on mostly peer-reviewed research is a sign that the media is sort of doing its job of saying this was an emergency. We should take a bit more risks and report on this stuff. Once the emergency's over, they go back to waiting until the research goes through its regular review process before reporting on it. So that's sort of a fun and exciting work, actually building on the work I'd done with Altmetrics and using that data from altmetric.com, but using it as a way of not to generate metrics, but rather as a source of data in order to better understand how research is circulating.
Yeah, these are very interesting findings. And as you said, I mean, there's a lot of alarmist voices are going around saying like preprint servers, that's going to be the end of the gatekeeping function of scholarly publishers, and scientists will just go the easy route and just publish stuff without peer review, and journalists don't understand the difference between peer-reviewed and peer-reviewed material and preprints, and so you found this is not the case.
We've also done interviews we've had interviews with journalists that are, in particular, we focused on some interviews with journalists that do science and health research. And we do find that there is a lot of misunderstanding of what preprints are. We did another study very early in the pandemic. In the first 6 months of the pandemic, we did a study, a content analysis of several hundred news stories, and saw that actually more than half the time, the media doesn't tell the public that it's not peer-reviewed. Actually, a lot of the time, they don't even tell them that it's research. They just sort of link out to the stories as a way of sort of as a citation in the media. So there is some of those that misunderstanding or lack of knowledge around these things continues to be there. But I think what we see is that the journalists that are trying to do a good job following good journalistic practices are doing the same kind of vetting that academics do in terms of trying to find additional sources. And they put a bit more scrutiny when it's a preprint than when it's not. When they see that label, this has not undergone peer review, they do make a bit of that extra effort. But more importantly, we're seeing that they go back to the falling on the traditional sources where they get their shoes. And that is often the journals with the most name recognition, which is their go-tos, their networks of scholars that they already have for validating and for identifying new sources. And those practices still override the novelty of taking a risk on a preprint. So my hope is that we see preprints remain as a primary source of scholarly communications or amongst researchers who do understand these distinctions, and that we continue to use journals as a way of providing a little bit of that filtering and certifying that the work has at least been accepted by the community.
Right. Yeah, and that is obviously my hope as well, being a publisher. And this is like what we do. We do the filtering, but we also do the knowledge translation piece. So we are also helping authors writing press releases, sometimes write press releases, do knowledge translation services. We offer visual abstracts and so on, just all to help to bring the research into practice. So yeah, Juan, it was really great to see you again and to have you talk a little bit about your research and successes. And I wish you continued success with PKP and all your other activities and research.
Likewise, let me extend explicitly the happy birthday to JMIR, and again to say my thank you for that starting point of my career, but also just to wish you it's been really great to see the rise and the growth of JMIR from being that single journal to being the publisher that it is today, and to see that you're continuing to innovate and trying to push the boundaries on the models of publishing and the technologies that are used to be able to support all of these things. You, I've continued to watch what you've been doing from afar and continue to be appreciative of your work. And so a big congratulations on the 25th anniversary to you and the team and to the continued success.
Thank you so much, Juan. And just to add to this APC publishing debate we had, we just heard couple of days ago that BIPSAM, the Swedish Library Consortium, is now only funding full open access publishers and will also fund JMIR publications. So all Swedish authors can publish in JMIR journals free of charge without any APCs for a flat fee. So that we are moving into that right direction.
Perfect. Good to hear.
Thank you. Thanks, Juan.
Take care.